if everybody will remain muted during the call, we will be taking questions. Questions will go in the chat. Please mention the wing. We're going to answer those questions back and forth. I'm going to ask for Lieutenant Kalidoss to help with those questions, and I'll hit them with an alternating format since I won't unfortunately know which wing any particular cadet is from. And we do encourage cadets, please start thinking about your questions and putting them in the chat, and we were going to call on as many as we can. The format for questions is we are going to ask the cadets to unmute themselves so that they'll have their opportunity to talk directly to Sian Proctor, who is giving them this space to inspire, which is great. So without any further ado, I'd like to welcome all of our VIPs and head people. I've got Ron Marks is the Arizona Wing Director of Aerospace Education. I'm Captain Russo, the Assistant Director of Aerospace Education. If I don't get to all of you, please, I can't see everybody. We have, of course, the California Wing Director of Aerospace Education had come on the call previously. We have one of the great people there is Lieutenant Kalidoss. I have my assistant in internal AE, Major Clara Alcott. I see the region head honcho, Lieutenant Colonel Varal. I know that some of the top people here, like Region Chief of Staff Jared Hoff, is on the call. Some good people. I think the I'm not sure because I'm not seeing her name, but I think that I was told that there was going to be a special visit here, probably by the region commander, Colonel Martha Morris. And if I've left you out, my apologies. It wasn't intentional. It's just seeing all the names, and of course, Dr. Sian Proctor. So I'm going to start with a piece together introduction that I stole from many Wikipedias and other sources. So, Sian Proctor, from humble beginnings to amazing heights, born in Guam to parents Edward Langley Proctor Jr. and Gloria Dolores, mother, Sian Proctor is the youngest of four siblings with two brothers. I hope that's right. Determined to reach space, Dr. Proctor received her PhD, a pilot's license, and scuba certification. In 2009, she was selected to participate in the final round of competitive astronaut selections, which consists of 3,500 applicants. She was a finalist of 47, and in the final round, unfortunately, 9 candidates were selected, and Sian's name wasn't there. But let's fast forward. Through fate and serendipity, Dr. Proctor was launched in the Earth orbit on September 15, 2021, as pilot of the Crew Dragon space capsule. We know that mission was the inspiration for a private orbital space flight. Now orbiting 75 miles higher than the International Space Station, this is a pretty substantial trip. As the pilot of the Inspiration 4 mission, Dr. Proctor is the first African-American woman to pilot a spacecraft. I think the White House should have you over. As a member of the Arizona Wing, Dr. Proctor serves as the Wing AE team and brings her experience to the cadets and seniors alike, like you tonight, and a proud member of the Sky Harbor Squadron, which I will get killed if I don't say that. She is here today. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce you to Sian Proctor. Let's give her a big round of applause.
Yay! Hi, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be here tonight to share my Space to Inspire story. I know with some of you, I got to chat before going to space about my experience, and now I'm just thrilled to be here to share what has happened over the last year with me. And so I have a PowerPoint that I want to do. And so what we're going to do is like about 20 minutes of me just sharing some of my experience, and then I'm going to open it up for the rest of the time to questions. And let me just optimize there and there and share. Okay. And can you see? Others can't hear you. Make sure that the microphone device, MacBook Pro, is on. Can you hear me?
Thank you.
Perfect.
Okay, yes, so I got a strange warning. So I just wanted to make sure that and you can all see my slides.
Yes.
Yes.
All right. So this is my Space to Inspire story that I want to share with you tonight. And I wanted to put everything in context of what happened to me last year. I'm going to start by playing this video.
The day of launch, I'm going to be thinking about how my entire life has led up to this moment. I was born on the island of Guam, and the reason why I was born there is that my dad worked for the NASA tracking station. And so I feel like space has always been a part of me. When I got that call, that Zoom, and Jared was on there, and he said that, you know, they picked me for the prosperity seat, that I was going to go to space with him and be part of the Inspiration 4, it really was like getting the golden ticket for Willy Wonka. Everything in my life finally came into focus, and I realized that it was all about this moment in time. I won the prosperity seat for Inspiration 4, and I did that not as a geoscientist or an explorer or an analog astronaut, which are all on my resume. I actually won this as a poet and an artist. We are striving for that Star Trek generation, that idea of a just, equitable, diverse, and inclusive space, or a Jedi space. I'm gonna be the first Black female pilot of a spacecraft ever. And to me, that just blows me away. And I wanna encourage the next generation to dream that this is possible. And a Jedi space, that's what that's about. I'm Dr. Sian Proctor, and I'm the mission pilot for Inspiration 4.
So that happened last year. And when I think back to that moment when I got the yes phone call, that was March 7th of 2021. So it was almost, I just had my 1 year anniversary of finding out that I had won. I had gotten my golden ticket to go to space. And you know, that's just this amazing life-changing moment, because when I was your age as a cadet, there were two things that I wanted to do. I wanted to be a fighter pilot, go to the Air Force Academy, become an F-16 fighter pilot, and then transition to becoming like Dr. Mae Jemison, the first Black female to go to space. Now, back when I was a kid, there was a couple of things. Dr. Mae Jemison hadn't flown yet. So all of my role models were from the Apollo age, because that's where I grew up with that. Being born on Guam, my dad was there at the NASA tracking station during the Apollo missions. So I grew up with Neil Armstrong's autograph to my dad. And so I always saw my ticket to space through being in the military and being part of the Civil Air Patrol. And I felt so lucky that my dad supported me in that endeavor by finding the Civil Air Patrol. And I was a cadet in upstate New York ages 13, 14, 15. And so just a wonderful experience. But then I got glasses. And back then you couldn't be a military aviator if you didn't have 20/20 vision. And so I kind of saw that my ability to go to space wasn't going to come true. Or, as you know, it did come true. But because I gave up on that pursuit, for the most part, when I was a teenager, I went off and I became Dr. Proctor. And so this picture was taken the day that I got my PhD at Arizona State University. And I became a geoscientist traveling around the world and learning about earth processes and getting scuba certified. I will say that I also got my pilot's license. As soon as I became Dr. Proctor, you know, that childhood dream of always wanting to fly, the next year I went off and got my private pilot's license. And, you know, I was teaching as a community college professor for the past 20 years at South Mountain Community College. So this was the world that I was living in until, you know, everything changed when I got this email in my late 30s saying NASA's looking for astronauts, you should apply. And I went through the selection process and I got down to the yes, no phone call. and it was a no. And so when you get those kinds of disappointments, because they're going to happen, you got to figure out how to move forward. And for me to move forward, I became what's called an analog astronaut, living in Moon and Mars simulations. And I was doing that, you know, because you have preparation and persistence. So preparation through things like the Civil Air Patrol, through traveling, through education, through all of those things. That's how you prepare for opportunity. And then you have persistence when you get setbacks, like a no. When you apply for something that you really want and you get a no, you have to persist through that and figure out ways of moving forward. And so then last year, a new opportunity came, and that was in the form of Inspiration 4. And so when I found out about this, I found out that there were two seats that they were giving away. One was the generosity seat. If you donated to St. Jude Children's Research Hospital, you could put your name in to be randomly drawn for that seat. And the other one was the prosperity seat, where you had to open up a shop, a digital shop, and sell some kind of goods and services and show your entrepreneurial spirit through a 2-minute and 20-second video. And so I became a space artist during COVID, and I thought, okay, if I'm gonna apply for this, I should apply as an artist and a poet, because being engaging in the arts really transformed me. And so I wanna play for you my winning video.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Sian Proctor, and I'm a geoscientist, explorer, and analog astronaut, and I have dreamed about going to space my entire life. I actually came that close when I was a finalist for the NASA astronaut selection process in 2009. But what I am most proud of is the fact that I have been a teacher at the community college for the past 20 years, and I have been able to inspire hundreds of thousands of students through my education and outreach. My entrepreneurial spirit lies in the fact that I combine space art with poetry. And my shop is called My Space to Inspire, and I've written an original poem to share with you. You've got space, I've got space, we all have space to inspire. That's why we dream of going higher and higher. But what is space if you can't breathe? Let's stop sucking out the air of our humanity. We have a moment to seize the light, Earth from space, both day and night. We have J for justice to ignite the bold. We have E for equity to cut past the old. We have D for diversity to end the fight. We have I for inclusion to try to make it right. A Jedi space to rally behind, a universal force so big it binds. Inspiration to change the world. A new beginning for us to hold. It's not about you, it's not about me, it's about space to inspire for all of humanity. Science, technology, engineering, and math, sending us out on the explorer's path. But don't forget the arts, the heartbeat of time. Consider sending a poet who knows how to rhyme. So let's drop the mic and close the capsule door. But please make sure Dr. Proctor is on board. My Space to Inspire is what we need. Inspiration for all of humanity. I hope you will go out and use your unique space to inspire those within your reach and beyond. Thank you.
So when I created this video, well, first of all, I wasn't even sure I was going to apply, because when I learned about the prosperity seat, I realized that there were a lot of other people who had amazing resumes and lots of followers online. And I thought to myself, well, you know, they're not gonna pick me. They're gonna pick somebody else. And a lot of times we have this voice inside our head that's going to fuel us with doubt of whether or not we could do anything. And so for me, what I said to myself, how I counter that voice, they call that the imposter syndrome voice. And the way that you I've learned to deal with it is by having a conversation with it and saying, well, okay, they may never select me, but what would happen if they did, you know, imagine if I did get selected? Or I will say, just me creating this video and posting it is a win, because it puts me out there and it gets me sharing my love of art and poetry in a way that I hadn't done before. And so sometimes you've got to look at those things as win and put yourself out there and apply for these things. And then of course, I was extremely lucky because I got selected, and I got selected for the prosperity seat through my creativity as a space artist. Now, what I find interesting is that I didn't become a space artist until I turned 50. So in 2020, while we were in COVID, I needed something to do because my normal, like my biggest hobby is traveling. And all of a sudden we found ourselves stuck at home because of the pandemic. And I didn't know what to do because I no longer could travel. And so I turned to art and poetry as a way to release my creativity. And then when Inspiration 4 came along, I knew that I had to apply using this new, what I call my authentic voice that appeared through the arts, even though I'm a scientist. And I'm gonna talk about how combining those things together, art and science, has really kind of changed my life. And so there are four seats: leadership, hope, generosity, and prosperity. Jared Isaacman, my commander, has the leadership role, and he is also the person who funded our mission to space. And he decided that he was gonna take three people that he didn't know. And that was Hope, Haley Arsenault, Generosity, Chris Sombroski, and me in the prosperity seat. And so we came together, literally our anniversary, our 1 year anniversary of us announcing to the world as a crew is March 30th. So next week we get to share our 1 year anniversary. And so as soon as we announced last year, March 30th, we were off to training. And the very next day, we flew to do the centrifuge to feel what it will be like, what it would be like, the G-forces upon us launching into space and returning. And besides that, I got to go into the SpaceX simulator, a lot of training with my commander as the mission pilot. And so what's interesting is that when Jared called me and said, hey, I want you to know that you won the prosperity seat, you know, that's my golden ticket moment. A lot of you, a lot of the older senior members will reference that to Willy Wonka, my getting the golden ticket. But soon after he said that, after he said, you know, you won the seat, he said, and I want you to be my mission pilot. Well, that was my Harry Potter moment. If you remember in Harry Potter, when Hagrid said, you're a wizard, Harry. And Harry says, I can't be a wizard. Well, you know, you can imagine when he said, I want you to be my mission pilot. And I was thinking, wait, what? I've only flown a Cessna 172. And now you want me to fly a Dragon capsule to space? Okay, I can do this. And so I had this fun time of going into the simulator and learning how to become the pilot of a spacecraft. But we also did things like we went and hiked Mount Rainier. And so this middle picture is me in a crevasse in a glacier on the side, you know, up on Mount Rainier. And we did a zero G flight, just different kinds of activities to get us flight ready for liftoff. And so we came together, the Inspiration 4 crew, and we were taking our Dragon capsule, our SpaceX Dragon capsule, on top of a Falcon 9 rocket. And what SpaceX did was they modified the top of our Dragon capsule, the nose cone area, and put a cupola or a window, a giant domed window on the top, so that we would be able to look back onto the Earth and have this amazing experience. And so when people ask me what was the most transformative part or the most amazing experience while I was up in space, it is by far this moment when we open up the cupola for the first time. Now, I want to tell you that I'm doing the filming, so that's why you won't see me. And I also, this is unedited. You're going to hear music playing. And the music that you're going to hear playing was on my iPad. So as soon as we were opening up the cupola, I thought it would be fun to play some special music for my crew members during this event. Now, what you're going to see is that Haley is going to start to pull out this ribbon, white ribbon material, because her job is to put a protective ring around the opening of the cupola so that it doesn't get damaged. Now, you're going to see her eventually look up. And when you do, you'll see how everything changes. And it's such an exciting moment. I'm so glad I captured that. Now, there is one colorful word language that is used during this video, and I'm going to try and bleep it out. I think that we'll all be okay with that. And here we go. Watch the opening of the cupola. And over in the corner, you can see our 0G indicator, which was that was our little doggy from St. Jude Children's Research Hospital as our 0G indicator.
Oh my gosh.
Watch Haley. Please.
Whoa.
Oh my gosh.
And that was such a special moment for me and my crew to be able to open up the forward hatch and to look out on our planet through this beautiful giant cupola. And what I want you to do is I want you to take a moment. We're going to do a thought exercise because I want to share with you why this moment was so transformative. Now, if you close your eyes, I want you to close your eyes and think about a full moon rising. And think about you're stepping outside and there is a full moon rising to the east. And think about how it makes you feel to be looking up at the full moon and being bathed in moonlight. Think about how bright it is outside just because of the moonlight and how you can walk and see because of it. And then think about how we've had myths and movies and TV shows and werewolves and all of these kinds of things written about moonlight. And think about our attachment to the way we feel under moonlight. Well, I've got to tell you that Earthlight, let me get to my next slide here. Oh, there we go. Earthlight is a 1,000 times more bright and beautiful and brilliant than moonlight. And so when we were opening up the cupola forward hatch to the cupola, you could see how our capsule got flooded with Earthlight. And I had known that Earthlight had a high reflectivity, but actually feeling it upon me, feeling Earthlight was transformative in the way that you get transformed in under moonlight. And so this picture shows you what I mean. You see this little dot down in the corner here? That is our moon. And think about how moonlight has an impact on how you feel. And now look at the Earth. And that's only a slice of the Earth. And you can imagine how the Earth is just beaming with energy, and it's a beacon out to our, the rest of the solar system. And so as an astronaut going up into space, you get the opportunity to be bathed in Earth light. And the views from space are just so amazing. We got to fly over South America on the left, Australia on the right. But what I really got an appreciation for were clouds, so many clouds, and the way that the clouds form patterns and swirl and move energy. They really are the regulators, along with the ocean, of the temperatures on our planet, between them and the ocean. And you could just see all of the colors, the white and the gray of the clouds, the blue of the ocean underneath. But to the left, is at night, being able to see the artificial lights of humans, and then the clouds, and then those white spots here, these are lightning. So that's lightning flashes. And it's amazing because from that perspective, it's like lightning going off every second, just ding, 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 all through the clouds, as you're traveling by. Just beautiful. And so I got to do two things that I'm really proud of while I was in space. One of them was I got to bring my family along. My dad worked for NASA during the Apollo missions, and he got Neil Armstrong's autograph right after Apollo 11. When Neil Armstrong came to Guam and thanked them for all their help. And so this has been a family heirloom since I was born. And it says to Ed, Ed is my dad. Thanks for all the help, Neil Armstrong, Apollo 11. And then I got to draw and paint in space. And so on the right side, there is my painting, my what I call Afro God painting. And I got to draw that and paint that while on orbit. And so two things that I got to do that were really special to me. Now, with opportunity comes responsibility. And there have only been three Black females who have flown to space before me: Dr. Mae Jemison, Joan Higginbotham, and Stephanie Wilson. And so I became the fourth Black female to go to space, and the first Black female to pilot a spacecraft. And so, with that responsibility of being a role model and encouraging other women of color and people of color to pursue space, and space exploration is something that I'm very passionate about. Jessica Watkins, here down on the bottom ring here, she's going up with Crew 4 next month, and I've had a chance to talk with her and to support her, and I'm so lucky to be in this position now. And so when we're talking about representation, for me, one of the things I mentioned about in my winning poem is what I call a Jedi space, a just, equitable, diverse, and inclusive space, and how important it is that we, as we write the narrative of human spaceflight right now, as we're going to the moon, Mars, and beyond, it's really important that we strive for this Jedi space if we truly want space to be for everyone. And so I found my authentic voice last year as an artist and a poet. It came to me late. I'm in my 50s, but I feel so thankful that through my art and poetry, I've been able to express things that I've been thinking about, and being able to win my seat to space as an artist and a poet. A lot of people ask me about my call sign because I went from Dr. Sian Proctor to Dr. Sian, quote, Leo Proctor. So my crew members call me Leo, and the Inspiration 4 team call me Leo. And a lot of people ask me, well, is that for low Earth orbit? Leo is short for low Earth orbit, where we were in space. And I'm like, no. And they say, well, is that because of your astrological sign is Leo, the lion? And I'm like, no. And it's actually because my crew members consider me a modern day Renaissance person. So I have started to combine art with science. So I'm a geoscientist, but I'm also an artist and a poet. And if we think about Leonardo da Vinci, That's exactly what he was during the Renaissance period. And then what has happened as the educational system has evolved, a lot of times people say you either track into the sciences or you track into the arts. And what my goal is to bring those things back and say, you don't have to choose between the arts and the sciences, because there's science in art and there's art in science. And so this idea of being a modern day Renaissance person. And so when I think about myself, I'm an educator, I'm an explorer, I'm an artist, I'm a geoscientist, I'm all of these things, including an astronaut. And you're gonna find that as you grow up and you get into the workforce and your career and all of that, you're gonna have all of these parts that are you. And you don't have to be defined as just one thing. You can be all of these things. They're all a part of you, the science, the art, the exploration, and to embrace the entire part of you and not in the entirety of you and not just parts of yourself. And so when I think of new space, I think of new ways of leading. When I think about old space, it was exclusive and competitive. For example, you know, going through the NASA astronaut selection process, it's about being the best of the best, highly competitive and exclusive, very hard to become a part of that. But this new space that's opening up is inclusive and complementary. So you as cadets, if you want to go to space and you want to be a part of people, you know, humans going to the moon, Mars and beyond, you are going to be able to do that because the landscape is changing. How we're selecting people, who we're selecting people, and the jobs we're taking up into space are changing. So you no longer have to be a fighter pilot and being, you know, being a scientist to get to space. You can go to space as an artist and a poet. You can go to space as a welder. You can go to space as, a structural, like an architect. So there's all of these things that you can think of. We're going to need them on the moon, Mars, and beyond. We're going to need all of these jobs, including new jobs that we haven't even given a title to yet. So as you go through your educational system, I want you to think about how to unleash the Renaissance person from within you and use your space to inspire those within your reach and beyond. And you do that. And while you're doing that, think about how you make your space. And when I talk about space to inspire, I'm talking about your space, the space that inhabits you, the space around you, the space that you take everywhere you go. It's with you 24/7. It's all about you and the things that you do. How do you make your space a space to inspire, and within that, a Jedi space, a just, equitable, diverse, and inclusive space? And so when you're thinking about yourself, think about how your well-being matters, taking care of yourself physically, mentally, emotionally, having empathy for the people around you, cultivating your strengths, thinking about what is it that you're good at and what do you love to do, finding mentors who can support you in the things that you want to do, finding people, activated allies, people who will go out of their way to make opportunity for you, being a good team member and why it's important to get along with the people around you. Again, value representation and diversity and being around people who aren't exactly like you. And embracing change, because change is going to happen whether you want it to happen or not. So not fearing change, but embracing change. And so those are some of the things that you should think about as you're moving through your schooling right now, but also as you get older into your adult life, that lifelong learning and using your space to inspire is always going to be a part of you. And so I'm just going to leave with the Netflix trailer, because I think a lot of you have seen the Netflix, but if you haven't, this is a little teaser of why you should go and watch it.
The reason I started SpaceX was to get humanity to Mars. We want to try to make the dream of space accessible to anyone. and ultimately making science fiction not fiction forever.
What they're about to do will change the game entirely. Four civilians are going to space. They will orbit the Earth for 3 days on their own.
You know, my dream of always wanting to go to space. I wanted to let you know that I got selected.
They start telling me about this all-civilian mission to space.
How many astronauts are going? And that's when she said, none. Haley was diagnosed with bone cancer.
I haven't died, and I'm not going to die.
Having cancer made me who I am.
My dream is to be a nurse.
I'm getting to show them what their life can look like after cancer. If I can do it, you can definitely do it.
Went upstairs after the phone call, though, and told my wife, I think I'm going to ride a rocket. And she just, what?
I don't think I'll think about the worldly impact this mission is going to have until Chris is back on the ground.
I'm like, why would they choose me? But my dad instilled this idea in me that I could do anything.
I'm commander of Inspiration 4. No matter what, I'm a father first, and that comes with a great deal of responsibility.
What is the speed?
Yeah, 25 times the speed of sound, or 17,500 miles an hour.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. It's getting real.
Our mission to space had to serve a bigger purpose, which is why it's a $200 million fundraising campaign for the St. Jude Children's Research Hospital.
There have been 3 Black female American astronauts who have made it to space. I will be number 4.
Start thinking about what could happen and the risks that are involved.
These people are you and me, and they will kick the doors open to space for the rest of us.
This is where we're going to live for 3 days.
Home sweet home.
So thank you for listening to my Space to Inspire story, and I would love to take some questions from cadets. Let me stop sharing my PowerPoint.
Outstanding. That was a great presentation. Everybody's got to give a big round of applause, and unmute yourself so she can hear it.
Thanks, everyone.
Bravo, bravo.
All right. So we have 2 sets of questions. Ones were the ones you guys sent in, and the others are the ones that are on the screen. So I will start with the questions that we received. We'll do a few of those that we got here in my email, and then we'll go to the cadet questions. So I'm gonna eliminate ones that were answered by the presentation. So I think the best question in this group is, how did being selected for this flight affect your views of dreams and goals coming true? I know a lot of people don't get selected for something, or they miss an opportunity in life and they think that that's it. But how did this change that for you? And now what do you think about goals and dreams coming true, and how does that affect you?
You know, I think the big thing is hope. I never gave up hope for going to space. And so it was, you know, and to some extent, when I got the no from NASA in 2009, I had to kind of reimagine how I was going to contribute to the advancement of human spaceflight. And when I did that, I still thought, well, maybe one day, you know, commercial space. And it was funny because in 2019, NASA put out a call for astronauts, and a lot of my friends were like, hey, are you applying? And at that time I was 49. I was like, no, I don't think I'm going to be able to make it as a NASA astronaut, but maybe one day I'll go to space to, you know, as a commercial astronaut, you know, as a civilian. And it's funny that to think that I actually said that consistently. And thinking that that might be a decade away, and here I am now, have gone to space. And so what I would say to my younger self, if I had the chance, I would say, don't give up hope. It, you can achieve your dreams at any age if you still have hope that they will come true. And so to all the cadets out there, you know, have hope. It might not become in the form that you think it will come. So originally, when I was your age, I thought it would be NASA as a fighter pilot, going through the Air Force Academy and you know, getting selected to NASA that way. That did not happen, but I still achieved my dream as an astronaut, in a way that I never even thought. To some extent, through winning a contest as an artist and a poet. And so don't give up hope.
All right. Your camera is off, Sian. I don't know if you noticed that.
I don't know why it went off.
There you go.
All right. Here I was being all animated and stuff.
Yeah. Well, we didn't see that. So.
Aw.
Another question we received was it hot or cold on the ship?
Oh, you know what? I was really afraid of being cold. We talked to other NASA astronauts who had flown up to the International Space Station on the Dragon capsule, and they all said that they were cold. And living in Phoenix, you know, I like to be warm. And so, but I was very comfortable. And so if you watch the Netflix documentary, you can see like Haley and them guys are in a short sleeve t-shirt, and I usually had a long sleeve something on, or sometimes I had my beanie on, but I wasn't cold and I wasn't hot. I was just at the right temperature. So SpaceX did a great job of regulating that. We also could request it, and we could change it. So on our touchscreens, if we wanted to be a little warmer or a little colder, we could have changed it, but we didn't have to make any adjustments.
So a typical car ride fight for the air conditioner control.
Right. We thought that there would be, because I run cold and Chris runs hot, but we were fine. And so it worked out great.
Very cool. Did you see space junk, the ISS, or satellites out the window?
I saw satellites, and I was one of the ones, and it was so funny, they were below us, and this was not out of the cupola, it was out of the side window. And so the dragon eyes, so the dragon capsule has two forward windows that you can look at also. And so I would go to that one and I'd look, and it would be funny because I'd be looking down and it was nighttime, during the nighttime. And I'd be like, oh, there goes a satellite. And then my crew members would be like, where? But you know, you're moving at 17,500 miles per hour and that's moving. And you're like, ah, it's gone, you know? And I'd be like, there goes another one. And so I think having been an astronomy person my entire life, and as a kid, I used to look up and try to find satellites. And so I was just kind of used to being able to track them.
Very cool. Of course, a lot of people had asked, did your iPhone get any signal?
No signal on the iPhone. You know, Starlink wasn't hooked up for that kind of thing. So a lot of people expected us to tweet and, you know, post on social media, but we had no ability to do that.
All right. Was there anything you regretted or forgot to do in space?
Yes. In the Dragon capsule, we were nose cone down to the Earth. And we all regret that we didn't reorient the capsule up away from Earth during nighttime so we could look out into the deep, dark star field and to see that from the cupola. So that was the one thing that we regretted, that we didn't take the time to do while we were in space for those 3 days. 3 days isn't enough. You got to go for at least 5.
You got to sign up for the week, guys. Remember that. Lieutenant Kalidoss, if you'd like to start with this first question from Eli Curtis, Cadet Airman First Class.
Sure. So, Cadet Airman Curtis, could you unmute yourself and ask this question, please?
What was running through your head during the launch and when you reached the highest point above the ISS?
Oh, I nothing but pure joy and excitement. You know, in the Netflix series, I think they capture it where I was so excited that day that I had made it, that I was finally going to space. And so the entire time I'm kind of like doing fist bumps and all excited. And then we have the liftoff And then, you know, 10 minutes later, you're in space and, you know, getting it onto orbit and unbuckling for the first time. I just remember just feeling, you know, my arms went like this and I was like, yeah, this is kind of new. And then I unbuckled and I just remember pushing out and the weightlessness for the first time. And it's really, you know, there's no sensation. It's not like you're a falling sensation on a roller coaster. You're just suspended. It's like Peter Pan, you know, you're just hanging there. And I was just amazed at how, you know, little energy it took to just move around the capsule because you don't have gravity pulling on you. And so just a wonderful experience.
A follow-up to that would be, does the zero gravity environment make you feel more energetic or younger, or does it give you, do you feel like less aches and pains for the older folks, you know, on the call?
Typically you get, I feel a little bit more achy in the sense, well, it's, you have a fluid shift. So your face and stuff and your head becomes puffy. So, you know, everybody has some form of space adaptation sickness because of that. One might be, you know, you got a headache. You have brain fog because you're just kind of like, oh, okay, this is a little different. Your spine elongates and, you know, cause you don't have gravity. So people talk about lower back pain as a result of that, getting up in space. You might have your stomach might be a little nauseous as a result of just, you know, that your inner ear trying to adapt to the fact that you can be in any orientation. Because you can be in any orientation doesn't mean that you don't, your brain doesn't want an orientation because you're used to training with cupola up. So you train in a 1G environment where everything, you have a sense of the top cupola or the forward hatch being up, you know, your seats, the forward hatch being forward, you know, not the forward hatch, the side hatch, you know, right, left. So I had Jared on my left, I had Chris on my right, I had, you know, the forward hatch up. So you have this sense of orientation, but then you're in space and you can be in any orientation and your inner ear is like, wait, what? Oh, you know? And so there's all kinds of things when you first get on orbit that can happen.
All right. Outstanding. The next question is from Cadet Staff Sergeant Cullum. Go ahead and unmute yourself and ask your question to Dr. Proctor. Okay, we'll move on until they can make it on. The next one, Lieutenant Kalidoss, go ahead.
Yeah, the next question is from Cadet Sergeant David Clark. Could you please unmute and go ahead with your question and probably with video as well?
Hello. Let me pull up my question right here real quick. So what did it sound like and feel like during the launch or ascent of the Crew Dragon?
Oh, it felt amazing. It was smoother than I thought it was going to be. And so it was kind of like, you know, you do have a little bit of vibration, but it's kind of like just going down a dirt road, but not enough to distract me from being able to read my screens. So a lot of times in the movies, they show you like, you know, not like that at all. It was smooth. And, you know, I am very focused and along with my commander on what the flight computer is doing in front of me. And so, I remember the roar, the rumbling, you know, sound, but and I remember that it was smoother than I thought, but most of myself, I was focused so much to make sure that the Dragon capsule was doing, well, the Falcon 9 rocket and the Dragon capsule was doing what it was supposed to do.
That's amazing. That's awesome.
It is quite the ride, I got to tell you.
Awesome. Hey guys, some of you all asked 3 or 4 questions in a row. And we're going to go through and get people's first questions. And if there's time, we're going to come back. So everybody has a chance to get in on the action. So please don't be upset about that. I have Vasilo Miguel. Vasilo?
Yes.
Are you there?
What do you wish you could have done as a child that could have really helped on becoming an astronaut?
Oh, that's a good question. You know, I think getting my pilot license early through Civil Air Patrol would have been amazing. You know, there wasn't quite as much opportunity because as a cadet, my squadron wasn't at an airport. It was at an auxiliary. I think it was, if I remember, like an army auxiliary location. So we didn't have plane and all of that kind of stuff. But I wish that I had gotten my pilot's license a lot earlier, at 16 instead of 36. I think that would have given me a leg up in many ways. So take advantage of the fact that you can fly with CAP.
All right. Hey, let's go to a raised hand senior question. I see we have Lieutenant Colonel Jackie Costas with her hand raised. Go ahead. Lieutenant Colonel Costas, can you hear us?
Yes.
Go ahead. You had your hand raised.
Yes, thank you so much for being with us. And I actually watch Netflix twice because I love it. I love space, and I lived through that documentary vicariously, because I was, as I was watching you, I was kind of feeling myself in that moment. So my question is, do you think, as a woman over 50 years old, is there any hope for space?
Yes, us seasoned individuals, there is absolutely hope. And that's one of the reasons why I like new space. You know, commercial space is giving opportunities that we couldn't imagine. In 1 year, last year, we flew the oldest person, Captain Kirk, William Shatner. We flew the youngest person, an 18-year-old. We flew DeHaley, who was a childhood cancer survivor and a prosthesis in her leg. We flew me as the mission pilot, the first Black female to be. So, I mean, the amount of sheer diversity in 1 year has been amazing. And so, and you take a look at how many people over the age of 50 that flew in the last year alone. I think Michael Strahan, he might be over 50. I don't actually know how old he is, but you know, a lot of the suborbital flights, just so much diversity. And so that's why I'm so excited. So as a seasoned individual, do not give up hope, because there's going to be plenty of opportunity to fly in the next decade and beyond.
I just wanted to say that Captain Kirk was looking up at Dr. Proctor's flight.
That is true. Suborbital versus orbital. But, you know, I like the fact that anyone going up, any opportunity to get up there and to have that view and feel Earthlight against your skin, you know, take it. And there are a lot of giveaways to space. So there, you know, Blue Origin, every flight they give away some to somebody. Again, it's an influencer, but at least they're giving away flights. But Virgin gave away a flight to, you know, a contest to win a flight last year, and that went to a Black female Caribbean person who her and her daughter will fly on a Virgin flight, hopefully in the next year. And I won my seat to space in a contest. So, you know, don't be afraid to apply for these things, because you just don't know.
There you go. Grab that next question, Lieutenant.
Oh, sure. Just give me a second. I just lost the screen here. The next question is from Keith. Keith, could you please unmute yourself, Keith Notek, and ask your questions, please?
Hi, Keith Notek from Prescott Squadron. Dr. Proctor, what was the best advice or insight that you received from a veteran astronaut before going into space?
Oh, there are so many good things. Let me think. That's a good question. My friend Scott Parazynski met with us, and he had all kinds of, every astronaut we talked to had some kind of like little nugget of information that was useful. You know, I think part of it, I'm trying to think of, there was one that stands out, and there wasn't anything that just comes to mind at the moment, but a lot of it was being like mindful of what you can take to space, bringing other people along with you, how to support your family and friends. You know, this is the most exciting thing for us, but it's probably the most terrifying thing, because they're so worried. They're excited for you, but they're also worried that something is going to go wrong. How do you prepare something for them in case something does go wrong? You know, so things like that were very helpful.
Thank you.
Excellent, excellent. Let's see. So the next three, so you can be ready, is Cadet Staff Sergeant Liu, Robert Scherfalo, and then we're going to go back to a senior member. I noticed we missed Lieutenant Colonel Markovitz. So go ahead and unmute yourself, Cadet Staff Sergeant Liu. I know you were one of the first ones here. Big fan.
Okay. What do you think the main difference is, as far as space flights go between the private sector and government funded and run missions?
You know, the biggest difference that I've seen so far is what you can do within a short period of time. So if you take it, you know, for a mission like what Jared, my commander, pulled off, that would take years to organize, I think, through the federal government side. You know, the average NASA astronaut doesn't fly for at least 2 years after being selected. We were selected and flew to space in 6 months. And so that's the power of commercial, is you've got the ability to select and fly in a much shorter time frame. And it's only going to get you know, more shorter as the technology and availability of flights increases. And so it's kind of interesting to think about that, huh? When you think about the fact that I was able to be selected and fly in 6 months. And again, that it's not since the shuttle era, but I think most of them was at least 2 years at the, my friend Scott Parazynski, he was able to fly within, he was selected and then 2 years later was his first flight.
All right, fantastic. Kalidoss, you want to call that next cadet up?
Sure. The next question is from Robert Scherfalo from Squadron 188, Oakland. Could you please unmute yourself and ask a question on video, please?
Oakland, are you on the line?
Yes. Hello. I'm senior member Robert Scherfalo, California Wing, Squadron 188. Hi, Doctor. Wonderful presentation. I had a question. How did traveling into space affect your artistic process?
Oh, you know, that I think I've been inspired to, you know, when I first came back, the things that I drew were definitely space inspired. And so the first thing that I ever created when I got back was this. Let me get it orientated right. And so you can see it was an Afro Gaia. Here's Mother Earth here. And then, you know, I have the cupola up in the corner here, you know, the open, and a SpaceX Dragon. So definitely inspired. And then, you know, I made the hair, the colors. I was just thinking about the blues and the grays and the whites of being in space. And then the other one that I did was based on getting my dragon wings. And so this is actually based on a real photo that I took while in space, the Earth there with the swirl of the clouds and stuff. But then having our dragon wings that we got, you know, that's a representation of the dragon wings that I painted and drew in space. So I think, you know, there's this kind of like sense of inspiration to that mission that is following me. I don't think I have my iPad here, but I recently did a self-portrait of me that I drew digitally. And it looks like this based off of my, you know, me going to space and my SpaceX helmet and stuff and learning how to draw faces and things like that. So it's something that is definitely present in my art is this experience. I've been thinking about how to express Earthlight through my art. It hasn't manifested yet, but I feel it coming, and I'm kind of like my brain is working on it.
Just a quick follow-up. The book you were holding up, I'm assuming that's a book of your art and your poetry.
Yeah, so this is my book called Space to Inspire, The Art of Inspiration. I self-published it on Amazon, and it follows my journey as an artist from, you know, being selected all the way through liftoff. And so it has my art and my poetry all in it.
Will there be any autographed copies for CAP members?
There are, and you can actually order an autographed copy off of my Space to Inspire website, which was the website that I, you know, created for to win my seat to space. Or if you, you know, just buy a copy and I see you somewhere along the way, I'll definitely sign it.
Thank you very much, Doctor.
All right, we're gonna go with Lieutenant Colonel Moskowitz. Markowitz, excuse me.
Thanks. Hello. What surprised you most about space traveling?
Oh, I know I sound like a broken record, but Earthlight, that surprised me the most. Even though I'm a geoscientist and I know that the Earth has a high reflectivity, I was like, what? It was so bright. Get out the sunglasses. Because when we were, keep in mind that video you saw, and if you see me up in the cupola or videos of us, you know, the nose cone, here are the solar panels in black and always facing the sun. And here's our nose cone. Our nose cone opens towards the sun. So our nose cone protected the cupola from direct sunlight at all times. So all of the light that's coming in when we're in that orientation of, you know, looking down at the Earth is Earth light, the reflected light coming off of the surface of the Earth. And again, this picture right here on the front, that's all Earthlight. That's not, we don't have lights in there. So being able to illuminate us during the daytime. And I just found that fascinating.
All right, I want to pick a rando to give everybody the fear you might be called on. Major Clara Olcott.
Good evening. Thank you, Captain Russo. Dr. Proctor, such an honor just to see you on the Zoom. Thank you for your time. I was wondering, first off, what other organizations are you with as far as like Women in Aviation, 99s, anything like that, that cadets can seek? And secondly, are there benefits if cadets were to look into the different space organizations and the internships? Would there be benefits for that?
Oh, yeah. So I've been a part of Women in Aviation, and I'm hoping that I couldn't go to the conference this year, but I was hoping that next year to be a part of that. And the local 99 chapter, I haven't been in a while with them, but I was definitely when I was more actively flying. As far as cadets, yes, take advantage of the fact that if you want to be a NASA astronaut or just an astronaut in general or work for NASA, you can do internships as a high school student. They have availability where you can go and do that. And when you get off to, you know, school, depending on what you want to do, higher ed, there are all kinds of internships with SpaceX. There's all kinds of programs to support you in that endeavor. And the thing about it is you just need to go and, unlike my day and some of the other seasoned adults on this call, when we had to have a, you know, we had to mail away for stuff, you had the internet. and so you can literally Google opportunities for yourself in space. And so take advantage of that, be a part, but take advantage of what all that, you know, CAP has to offer, because there are great things. I mean, when I was a cadet, going to encampments, going on, you know, participate in all of the activities, get your ham radio license, go and do the search and rescue, get qualified in all of these different areas. And enjoy, you know, the process, and particularly fly, because it's there for you to take advantage of. You'll be amazed at how having those things from Civil Air Patrol on your resume at a young age, and then going to SpaceX and saying, I want to intern, or going to NASA and saying, I want to intern, that's going to be, they're going to be like, wow, this person's a total rock star. And so take advantage of those things.
Thank you so much, Dr. Parker.
Outstanding. Lieutenant Kalidesh, you want to pick it up from Tristan Castro?
Sure. Tristan Castro from California Wing, could you please unmute yourself and probably come on video as well and ask your question?
Yeah. Tristan Castro from the San Fernando Cadet Squadron 137.
Hi.
California. Yeah, I was wondering, how different is piloting a spacecraft compared to a regular aircraft?
Oh, night and day. And so when Jared said, I think you should be my mission pilot. And I was like, does he know that I only fly a Cessna 172? And that was a decade ago, but it's actually a modern day pilot of a spacecraft is a systems engineer. And so there's no stick and rudder or any of that kind of thing. And so you literally have touchscreen panels, and my job was to understand the Dragon capsule systems inside and out. And so I had two primary things. One was to back up my commander, because, you know, and Jared is a pilot, and, you know, he has ultimate responsibility of the spacecraft and everybody on it. And everybody has a primary and a backup. So I'm his backup. We both got trained on all the systems and how to work together as a team. But my job as the pilot is that I understand all the systems and all of the pages, and I can pull up if an alert happens or something goes wrong. I can pull up that system and I can, you know, help him get situational awareness on what's being impacted and what we can do about that, with the help of SpaceX. And so systems engineering.
Just a follow-up question to that, Sian, because I had a follow-up question to that. What role did the ops play in a situation like that? If you have a manual override situation, like, what did Sarah tell you, Sarah Gillis?
Wait, say that again.
What did the SpaceX team, Sarah?
Sarah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mission control, you mean during the mission, what role did she play and stuff like
that? Yeah, I mean, in case you had a manual override situation or a foreign object impact situation that happened on Crew 2, what will be her advice to you? Will she advise you on the controls that you should take, or just the precautions?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, you got to understand it. SpaceX will be, if we have contact with ground station, they will advise us on what to do, but they can take control of the Dragon capsule itself. And they'll send commands for it to do things. So, we have controls that we can do. Like Jared and I were trained on how to do an emergency deorbit and things like that. Because you don't know if you're over a ground station or have what's called TDRS communication with SpaceX. But so if you lose communications, we learned how to be able to do things on our own. But when you do have communications, there are rock stars down there. There are people who know every system. I mean, 24/7, you have somebody who is specialized in every single system on you know, listening in to the entire time, and they do shifts. They do 3 hours. They do you know, shifts, 8 hours or something like that, where they're sitting there making sure that nothing's going wrong, and if something's going wrong, how to mitigate it.
And we have here a controversial confidential document obtained from SpaceX that says, do not allow Sian to take manual control as she will fly to Mars.
Well, I definitely would have said we're not deorbiting after 3 days. I'm like, we're going around for a couple more
going around
a few more times. I would have been like 5 days, see you in two more, SpaceX. So
personally, I wanted you to go to the International Space Station, Sian.
I wouldn't mind going to the ISS, but I really want to go to one of the new ones that are being built, you know, like Orbital Reef or something. That seems like that's going to be awesome. You know,
just don't go to Zagama Beach. if anybody remembers the old Starship Trooper joke. Okay, I think we're going to call one of the VIPs from California, Major Kathy Cullum, the DAE.
Good evening. Thank you so much for being here. One of the things, you know, somebody stole my question because I'm a pilot myself, and I'm thinking transferring my 172 skills to a mission capsule like that, going, oh my Lord, I can't even believe that one. You know, you threw me away when you said that. But the other thing that it seemed like is that you physically, what did you have to do physically to get yourself in shape in order to make this work? You know, how did you have to strengthen yourself, or, you know, what kind of regimens did you put you through in order to get your body ready for this kind of mission?
Yeah, you know, we had a personal trainer who was there to try and keep us motivated, particularly because, you know, that 6 months you're traveling a lot, you're eating out a lot, you know, you're stressed out because you're trying to, you know, learn all this material and do the best that you can. Luckily, going into Inspiration 4, I already was getting in shape. I was hiking a lot consistently because for my birthday, I was going to do the rim, you know, rim to river to rim of the Grand Canyon in a day. And then Inspiration 4 came, and instead of doing that, I was announcing that I was going to space. And so a lot of it was about maintaining that level of activity. But what's funny is that I consider myself a hiker, and there was nothing harder than hiking that Mount Rainier mountain. I mean, after it was 9.5 hours of steep and steeper. And what I learned from myself, and this is, you know, cadets, you learn something all the time, every day. And what I learned from that is that I am not a mountaineer person. I'm a hiker, but not a mountaineer, and I'm a fair weather hiker. And so I own these snow boots, these boots specifically made for mountaineering. And I'm like, put them at the back of the closet. because I am like, well, I have no desire to hike to the top of a snowy peak.
Was that mandatory? I kind of got lost on that one. Was that a required thing for you guys to do?
Yep. Our commander, it's about becoming comfortable with being uncomfortable. And so that was our crew bonding experience. And so typically all of NASA astronauts, the crews go on a NOLS, like a NOLS is an outdoor adventure kind of extreme environment challenge together, because nothing bonds you more than going, you know, to space. But before you go to space, going out and taking on some kind of challenging activity together. And
couldn't you just stay in Phoenix during the summer with no air conditioner?
Yeah, or just locked up in a habitat. We could have gone to the high seas hab and just hung out there. Yeah, but you know, that's the thing, is like, how do you bond in some kind of extreme environment?
Wow, that's some great insight. Oh, I think we're gonna go to Roseanne Marquez.
Encampment is a form of that too, where you go out and you know, I remember my encampment when I was a cadet.
Hi, Sian.
Hi.
It's great to see you. My question has to do with having had the opportunity before you went to space, and the pleasure to have had conversations with you at the squadron level. We got to hear about you, you know, being excited about upcoming projects and hear about how much you actually wanted to go to space. So I've been following you through this journey since before it happened, and it's living vicariously through you.
It's been
such a wonderful thing to see you go through it and have your dream come true. That being said, what do you think that you feel is the thing that has changed the most about you having gone to space?
Access up to people and opportunity. I am amazed at the things that come into my email every single day, you know, where I'm just like, wait, what? Wait, is this an invitation to where? With who? And so I feel so fortunate that I now kind of have this global platform and awareness, but also, you know, opportunity to go and meet people and to have experiences that I never thought I would have before. An example is that I got invited to Necker Island, which is the private island of Richard Branson. And so I got to go there, and not only did I meet him, it was for an ocean marine conference. But now I'm connected to all of these amazing people doing amazing things to save our oceans. And so stuff like that, every day, even though I get way too many emails and I can't keep up, it's a treat to go through and try to, you know, answer them and see what kind of opportunities are coming my way.
I saw the picture of you and Richard Branson jumping off the boat.
Yeah.
And, you know, I show everyone, I was like, wow, she's just meeting people right and left. It's opened up so many doors for you. So I'm really
amazed. But that's the thing for the, you know, for the cadets, is that when you take, when you put yourself out there and you engage in opportunities and push yourself, you don't know what the ripple effect is going to be. And that's what's fun about it. And so don't be afraid to go out there and to do things and to engage in the world around you. And make connections. It's really about, you know, our life is about connections with others, and how you're using your space, the space here, to inspire those within your reach and beyond.
That's outstanding.
Thank you.
I think everybody can kind of connect with that. And, you know, I want to call one of, and I'm sure everyone will agree, one of our most important members. It's a AEM. And AEMs are an incredible part of the CAP experience, and us bringing the aerospace propeller to the outside world. And with that, I'd like to call Kimberly Isley.
Good evening. Thank you for just allowing me to participate and join in. I'm a teacher of special education in primary school, but they just love space, and it's amazing. I have posters all over the wall, and I have kids that come in, and we had a great discussion about Pluto the other day. It was amazing, just off the wall. I'm curious though, thank you for sharing that you guys had that hike, becoming comfortable with what's uncomfortable, because I think that's the best way to kind of see somebody's true self. I'm curious what else you did as a team to support and strengthen the social emotional health of the crew, just as you were very quickly going through your preparation and then those 3 very short days you had.
Oh, we had all kinds of, you know, like, I mean, being with the crew was one of the ways in which we could bond and, you know, create a sense of family. But we also had, you know, a psychologist that we could talk to about, you know, what was happening. We had medical doctors. We had all of the, you know, kind of the support staff that you would want to have for going through this type of thing. But I think one of the best things that came out was just spending time with, you know, Jared and Chris and Haley in all kinds of different types of scenarios, whether it's going to the 0G or the doing the hyperbaric chamber, and you know, Haley's one of my best friends now. I was just chatting with her earlier today, and I was telling her how one of my favorite videos is this one where, you know, we're flying in space and we're up in the cupola together and our hair is just going everywhere. And I'm like, I want Haley hair. And we were just laughing and just those kinds of things, you know, those moments bond you in ways that you just, you never would have imagined. And there, I had so many of them. So mental health wise and just, you know, she's the person who I will reach out to because we have the shared experience and we can be like, oh, you know, how are you adjusting being back? You know, what are you doing? How are you doing? Just checking in on each other.
Thank you so much for your input. I appreciate it.
Excellent.
I only have a few minutes left. I don't know if there's anybody.
Uh-oh, we're going to get a hard cutoff here. And our apologies if we don't get to you. We're trying to get everybody in, but this is a top flight American hero you're talking to here, which I'm sure you've seen.
Well, we have a few more minutes to get through.
So let's go with go ahead, Lieutenant. We have Airman Hudson.
Yep.
Hi,
go ahead.
Sorry. This is Cadet Senior Airman Hudson from Arizona Wing Squadron 301. So I was wondering, I know you talked about the G-force, and I was wondering how you felt when that amount of G-force hit you in flight.
I got to tell you, going up, not a big deal. Coming back, because once you've been in microgravity for 3 days, I tell this story how I just, it just makes me laugh. We you know, you kick off the trunk and then you're coming in with your heat shield and you hit the atmosphere because you're going 17,500 miles per hour. So you've got to take all of that energy out through how you enter into the atmosphere. And I just remember we were just to 0.3 G, not even 1 G. 0.3, and we're all like, and Haley goes, what, you know, she kind of like gasped, and we're like, whoa, that elephant has already felt like it was sitting on our chest. And by the time you're getting up to 6, you know, I just remember I was pressure breathing going, okay, this is what we trained for. So it was kind of funny. I enjoyed it though. I enjoyed every minute of that. When people ask about both, they're just different. Liftoff, and then ascent coming back, and then descending back into the to Earth. They are different enough from each other that they're two completely different rides. Both enjoyable though.
All right, let's keep moving on. One of the questions was, is your favorite aircraft still the F-16?
Yes.
Did Jared let you fly one of his fighter jets?
Oh yeah, I got to fly the MiG-29. I mean, obviously from the back seat, but the MiG-29. I mean, that's really the closest thing to getting to the F-16. And just the afterburners and the power so he gave me control and I got to, you know, fly it. It flew, you know, relatively smooth. And I think I surprised them a little bit because I was able to, like, you know, take control and be fine. But I gotta say that, he did a nice long, turn burn and where we pulled 6 and he just held it there. And it was great because, that really kind of gave me insight into what we were going to have, what was going to happen when we were coming back into the atmosphere. I also got to fly in the L-39 and take the stick there and in an Alpha jet. And in both of those times though, we flew formation. And that was fun because I got to take the stick and be, you know, we were out on the outer wing when I was flying in the Alpha jet. And so I was far enough away to not like, But formation flying, wow, where you're tight, because all of the people, Jared has done formation flying, but all of the team, the Inspiration 4 team, like Kid, who was on that call and who's going up with Jared, they're all ex Thunderbird pilots. Like, he's surrounded by all these amazing pilots. And so we did a flyby over our Falcon 9 rocket, and man, we were tight. And well, you're like, whoa, you're right off the wing of everybody. And it's so cool.
Oh, that's an amazing adventure. I think we've almost got everybody. There's the Cadet Senior Master Sergeant Vineyard. Come now with your question.
Hi, and thank you again for doing this. Did seeing the galaxy make you realize how much more humanity has to discover?
Oh, isn't it true? Just looking up. I mean, that's one of the things that I am very passionate about is astronomy outreach, and just thinking about how vast it is out there. And just this kind of sense of wanting to know, wanting to get out there. I want Star Trek, you know, not Star Wars, although I enjoy Star Wars, but who wants to fight across the galaxy when you can trek, right? So I am so ready for us to get into that, figure out warp drive and being able to go visit all different kinds of places across our galaxy and hopefully beyond.
That's awesome. I think this is the question we're gonna end with. It's from Scott Curtis. Scott?
Scott Curtis. Great presentation. Envious of your flight. And just wondering if you think there would be an opportunity for you to go back to space in the future.
I would like to think that there will be. I want to be a moonwalker. Not to say that I wouldn't turn down Mars, because I would, but I think that there will be an opportunity, particularly, you know, older in life, to be able to potentially go to Mars, because we want to send, to some extent, seasoned individuals because of the radiation issue, and knowing that, you know, you can go if you send somebody who's in their 60s, who is capable and competent and has all this history and knowledge, you know, and knowing that the radiation exposure to go there and back, that it's a good chance that they'll get cancer in 30 years. Well, they're 90, you know, versus sending somebody who's, you know, 20 something or 30, and potentially cutting their life short. And so because of that, so I think that there's going to be opportunity for us seasoned individuals to be able to do some amazing things in space.
Got it. That's just outstanding. And I think that this presentation should be a space to inspire all of you, to live your dreams and to realize that at no age really has it been cut off from you. And even when you think the doors are closed, those doors are still opening, and the future is coming at us at an incredible rate. And to the cadets, I think you should work very hard on your promotions and your education and, experiencing everything you can and taking advantage of your O-rides and getting up there and even doing mission skills, you know, work on that drone program, the drone tech program.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And coding is the language.
Coding,
you need.
Yeah.
If you're going to learn one language, learn coding.
So, yeah, learn to code, learn to fly, stay in the Civil Air Patrol and, promote and stay vigilant and don't give up ever on any dreams or let any doors shut on you, because as we can see from Sian, a perfect example of how you never know what is coming around the corner. Thank everybody. Let's give a good round of applause and thank you for Sian and her presentation.
Thanks, everyone. I want to see if I could
unmute everybody. Hold on.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye,
bye everyone. Bye. Have a great night.
Thank you.
Thanks, Sian.
Thank you for tuning in.
Thank you very much. Nice job, Brett.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone.
I just want to let you know, from you have an open invitation to California here. So
oh, thank you.
You know, when it gets to be like 105, 110 there, we have beaches here, you know, we have, you know, San Diego, we have kind of cool areas here. So,
I've been California dreaming my entire life. So I may just take you up on that.
You know, you've got Kailash here. Kailash, you got her number. So once that July weather starts hitting in, August hitting in, you let us know and we will find you a place and get you to cool off.
Sounds good. Thanks.
On behalf of California, thank you very much, y'all, for inviting us.
You bet. Thank you.
Thank you for coming, California.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.